I wanted to start, because it's 15 years after September 11th, obviously, just by asking you, Larry, where were you then, and how did you find out about it, and what was your first reaction to the attacks?
I live in Austin, and I was on Tuesdays, I was part of a group, we have breakfast and speak Spanish. So I was speaking Spanish at the time, and I got into the car, and NPR was on and said a plane had hit the Trade Center. And by the time I got back home, the second plane had hit. You remember that the planes were grounded for a period of time, several days after 9/11. And my first instinct was, I've got to get up there. But I couldn't. And also the phones were out in Manhattan for a while. So I sent an email to my editor, David Remnick, saying, put me to work. The phones came back on sometime after noon. There were New Yorker correspondents scattered all around in the middle of their stories, you know, wherever they might be. And so, I remember Jane Mayer and Jeff Goldberg were in Washington, and you could hear the sirens on the street racing to the Pentagon. And I was in Austin feeling very trapped and not knowing how I could participate. David said, I just want you guys to find stories and send them to me, and I will take them and meld them into some kind of narrative. And, you know, this was Tuesday. Normally the magazine closes at Thursday noon. So, you know, there was a terrible crush. I was fortunate through, you know, making a lot of calls and so on, that I found this young man in New York named Kurt Yeltsin. And he was a young reporter. He had been supposed to have an interview that morning at 9 o'clock on the Windows of the World restaurant on the 110th floor of the World Trade Center. And for the first time in his life, he fell asleep on the subway and missed his stop. So he jumped off and got on the next train, got off at the Chambers Street station, raced into the Trade Center, and for those of you who were never in the Trade Center, there was an escalator that led up to the elevator bank, and there were 108 elevators. So he went up the escalator, he got on an elevator, and the elevator attendant held the door for this very well put together businesswoman. And Kurt was looking at it, well, he's a young person, he was looking at his phone to see what time it was. And this woman stepped onto the elevator, and Kurt noticed that she had a rose tattoo on her her ankle, and the plane hit. So that was like the last moment of innocence in some ways, because nobody knew what had happened. Was it an earthquake, or a bomb? What could it be? And disoriented, he walked out of the elevator into the lobby, and there were objects on the floor, and he probably pieces of concrete or plaster, but some were the size of alarm clocks, some were the size of office desks. And he saw outside, and he'd forgotten that he'd taken that escalator up, so he thought he was leaving the building. And he walked out on this terrace, and he saw hundreds of shoes. And then he saw something that looked like suitcases, and they were human torsos. So his story of getting back to Queens became the bookend for the famous black issue of The New Yorker. And that was, my introduction to what would be the next 5 years of my life.
And why did you know you had to follow that particular story?
Well, in some ways, I had been preparing for it for a long time. As a young man, I taught English at the American University in Cairo. And I studied Arabic for no other reason than for fun. I didn't have any idea that it was going to be consequential in my life. And as a reporter, I'd been in the Middle East somewhat before 9/11. I had written a movie called The Siege that, in certain creepy ways, prefigured 9/11. The idea of the movie was what would happen if terrorism came to the United States the same way that it had already visited Paris, London. What if it happened in New York? So I studied, how we behaved in the past, how other countries handled terrorism. I came to New York, and I interviewed people in the FBI. And then it was a box office failure because Arabs were already tired of being stereotyped as terrorists. And
it was like 1998, right?
Something 1998. Like and there are a lot of things about that movie that kind of haunt me still. One is that al-Qaeda, when I was writing it, had not yet struck America. But in August of 1998, they hit the American embassies in East Africa, killing 224 people. And in that same month, the trailers for The Siege came out. And because of the trailers, because in the trailers they depicted Muslims at prayer, there was a bombing in Cape Town, South Africa. And the Islamist group that claimed credit said they'd done it because of the siege, and the building that was hit was Planet Hollywood. Two people were killed, and a little girl lost her leg. And the reason they struck Planet Hollywood is that Bruce Willis, who was one of the co-stars, was a partial owner of Planet Hollywood. So here I had written a movie, and people were dead. It was very upsetting to me, and then the movie came out. Arabs picketed the movie, even though some of the organizations that organized this, I had consulted. We'd actually paid them, to consult on the movie, and then it was very bitter experience. I was angry about it, and so it was a box office failure. And it was the most rented movie in America after 9/11.
Which tells you something.
Well, there was another thing. It's so weird to me about that movie. The character that Denzel Washington plays, the real person that held that job was John O'Neill, who became central to my Looming Tower book and figures into this book as well. And then while I was researching it, I heard about this young Lebanese-American agent who is undercover. I couldn't meet him. But the idea of that character became the character that Tony Shalhoub plays in the movie, this Arab-American hero, despite all of the protests. I think that was unnoticed. And then he became a huge source for me after 9/11.
That's Ali Sufan.
Ali Sufan, and there's a chapter in the book about how he might have been able to stop 9/11 had the CIA cooperated with his investigation of the coal bombing in Yemen in October of 2000.
Let's talk a bit about the book, because obviously a lot of the book has been in articles in The New Yorker over the past 15 years. What made you want to bring those together and sort of refashion them in a way for readers now? And what do you think readers will take away looking at the entire, all the compendium of articles together versus having read them one or two over the years?
Well, my editor and I were talking about doing a collection. And, originally the idea was we just, I've been writing for a long time. I got a lot of articles. And so I started looking over the whole body of work, and I realized there were so many articles. I'd have forgotten how many articles I'd written about terrorism since 9/11. And I decided to take a look at them as a separate, and I found that they told a coherent narrative of how al-Qaeda and then ISIS evolved and changed over time. And it was different from the Looming Tower, but it was still a way of looking at the way that how terrorism has changed and how we as a country have changed in response to it. So I thought that that would be worth putting together.
It's interesting. In the middle of the book, there are these two chapters. One is on Saudi and the other is on Syria, and they seem to have less to do with terrorism than the rest of the book. They seem to have more to do about art in repressive or media in repressive regimes. So what made you want to include those in this book that's called The Terror Years?
Well, in the case of Saudi Arabia, they wouldn't let me in, you know, for more than a year. They weren't going to let any journalists in. And
because it was right around the time before Iraq was happening, correct?
Yeah, yeah. I actually was there when the Iraq invasion was. But the only way I got in is I took a job. I became an expat worker, which is something they understand in Saudi Arabia. And the job I got was mentoring young reporters at this newspaper in Jeddah, which is bin Laden's hometown, which is exactly where I wanted to be. And it was a briar patch for me, you know. But normally, if you're a reporter, as you know, you fly in, you stay at the Hilton, you make some telephone calls, and you try to arrange some meetings. Instead of that, I had a job, had to go to work every day. I had a car. I lived in a middle class Saudi flat.
Horrible for a New Yorker writer to have to actually go to the office every day.
And I had all these young reporters teaching me so much more about their culture than I could ever have imagined when I was sitting in the room in the Hilton. So, and it was a revelation to me. There was so much, I learned so much that I couldn't have understood about what gave rise to the despair that I think is the predicate for terrorism. And, you know, things that I hadn't expected, like one of my reporters did a study on depression at King Abdul Aziz University, which was bin Laden's alma mater. And most of the students showed actual symptoms of depression. And I don't remember all the figures, but one that I really remember is that 7% of the girls admitted that they had attempted suicide. Now, this is a huge taboo in an Islamic culture. But that's a high figure anywhere. And I was constantly, some of my reporters were really depressed. Mm-hmm. I remember when I was at a gym, and of course, like all institutions, men only, you know, I mean, there were no women around, but I was doing some yoga, so I was standing on my head, and this Saudi guy came over and said, "Would that be good for depression?" So I set him up against the wall because maybe it was good for depression. But there was this open acknowledgement that they felt so sad, so squelched, so spurned by the world and the opportunities that might have been open to the others weren't open to them. And I could just feel this sense of despair that was the place was just soaking in it. As for Syria, I went just before the Arab Spring, and what drew me to it was, as you know, the Middle East is a very voluble, it's paradise for reporters. You know,
right.
People talk. Except in Syria, it occurred to me that there was no news coming out of Syria. It was like the dog that didn't bark, and I just wondered, what's going on?
Mm-hmm.
And I mentioned it to my editor, and it's not very good story lead that there's no news out of Syria is not the
thing. Send me. There's nothing going on there.
So, but I decided that how other cultures know America so often is through our movies. So I decided I would go to Syria and watch their movies and interview their filmmakers and see, you know, if I can understand their culture. And what I found in Syria was the common element was physical abuse. Everybody I met had been beaten. in every film is about abuse. Everybody had been beaten by their parents or their teachers or the police or whatever. It was universal. And it really made me understand that this was not just one obstinate dictator. This was a whole culture of trauma. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, when things developed as they did, I can't say, I was not just surprised, I was appalled at how it took this turn towards violence. But the level of trauma and wounds that were already present in that culture, I think, laid the predicate for this catastrophe that we see now.
The despair that you mentioned earlier really comes across in the chapter on Gaza. It's, you know, the whole idea that nobody cares about anything that's happening to us, and particularly I believe he was a doctor talking remotely to, and after his family was bombed. But you write about the whole idea that your take on the internal and wanting to sort of give voice to that externally, the fact that people who are abused want to take that out and make other people. Can you talk a little bit about that whole idea? Because I thought it was a really interesting way to talk about the rise of terrorism and why people might, you know, go in that direction, because it's not necessarily poverty. It's not necessarily all the things that we think about.
Well, you know, there's no one thing that leads people to be radicalized and turn into terrorists. There are, you know, many, many different things. And everything has been explored, poverty, lack of education, absence of employment opportunities, gender apartheid, tyranny. You know, there's a tremendous list. And each of them by themselves hasn't been shown to cause terrorism. But in my opinion, they are all tributaries in this huge river of despair that runs through the Arab and Muslim worlds. And, you know, there are many different ways it can be expressed. But I think that people who grow up, you know, it's been shown in sociological studies that people who grow up in, you know, who are abused as children, for instance, are more likely to become abusers themselves. And I think I extrapolate a little bit from that intuitively, that if you have a turbulent background and a turbulent worldview, or a violent or cruel, sadistic, whatever, in some way, you want the world to be more like what's inside you, so you find equilibrium. It's not, of course, there are many people that want to improve themselves and become kinder and more, you know, more loving and so on. But there are other people that simply want to bring everything down to their level, and the opposite of that is characterized by these young Americans who were murdered by ISIS, who were so idealistic. And, you know, they went into a very dangerous situation hoping to bring knowledge and insight and medical assistance to people who are direly in need. And the young people that I wrote about came from wonderful homes. They, you know, their backgrounds were full of love and trust and so on. And they wanted to make the world more like that.
Reading those chapters is some of the most difficult stuff in the book, and not just because, you know, I'm a journalist, but just because of what happened to those families. How did you gain the trust of those families? It almost felt like you were in the room with David Bradley. How did you get everybody to talk to you about what was happening, about such a sensitive subject?
Well, let's start with the fact that David Bradley, she mentions, is the publisher of The Atlantic. And I work for The New Yorker, so I heard about David Bradley's attempt to help these American families recover their children from ISIS. And the government wasn't doing anything to help. In fact, it was standing in the way. I talked to David Remnick, and I said, I'd like to write about David Bradley. He said, you've got to be kidding, you know. And then I talked to The Atlantic, and I said, I'd like to write about David and what he's doing, and we're going to do it ourselves. Thank you very much. And so my argument was, you can't do it. You can't write about your publisher that way. I can. And
did that actually work?
Well, it kind of did. But then I had to convince Remnick, and then so Remnick and Bradley had these conversations, and there was a prolonged negotiation about whether this was going to happen or not. But I was determined. I mean, I was on fire to do this story. And so once David consented, he actually asked me to come and meet him before he did. So we have a, you know, kind of man to man, you know, size each other up. And he consented. But the truth is, these families loved him. What he had done for them was extraordinary. You know, his own expenditure of money and his own time, he put his staff to work on this. And while the government is actively obstructing any effort to try to free these kids, David was using all his ingenuity, all his connections, and a good portion of his wealth to try to free these five Americans. And he did succeed in bringing one of them home. He faults himself for not having more success, but you know, these kids were doomed, and the fact that he was able to rescue one of them is a great human story.
What do you think that whole situation means for coverage in that region and what we actually know about what's happening with ISIS and in Syria?
Well, you know, magazines have changed their approach. When I was doing The Looming Tower, I, like most reporters, I felt I had a sort of immunity. You know, I could wander through the Middle East and say, I'm a reporter, and people would honor that. Now, reporters have targets on their back. You know, we're hunted. And it's not the same place anymore. I'm not sure how I would advise young reporters to deal with that now. I know that The New Yorker and The Atlantic and other publications are now extremely cautious about using freelance reporters. The problem is that freelance reporters were the only ones there. You know, these big corporations, you know, they pulled their staff people out of there because it wasn't safe. And then the region is open up to these young people who want the opportunity for the big story. And otherwise, there is no story. Nobody's getting the story. So people like Jim Foley and Steve Sotloff, you know, they flooded the zone and they got stories. They were writing. Steve Sotloff spent a year and a half writing for Time and other magazines under extraordinary conditions of danger. In that time, he never earned enough money to file a tax return.
Yeah, that was such a stunning detail. I mean, just shows you the value of news over there and what the fact that people right. are risking their lives to tell these stories.
Yeah.
You'd mentioned the whole idea that America stood in the way and the government stood in the way of those families being able to try to get their loved ones back. Talk about some of the other American intelligence and government failures over the years. If you just want to, you know, give a top five or top three. It comes through very solidly in the book.
I honestly, after 15 years, I thought some of these questions would be answered and some of the people responsible for these failures would be held accountable, and that hasn't happened. I'm just going to talk about a couple of them because they gnaw on me so much. One is, I wrote about this in The Looming Tower and also in the Ali Soufan chapter in this book. The CIA knew that two al-Qaeda hijackers, they didn't know they were hijackers, they knew they were in al-Qaeda, arrived in America January 15, 2000, just 20 months before 9/11. In fact, the Saudis had told them previously these guys were in al-Qaeda. So in March of 2000, the CIA finds out about it, and there's a memo written about these two al-Qaeda guys in San Diego. They're living in San Diego. according to the Inspector General of the CIA, their own oversight guy, 50 to 60 people in the CIA read the memo. They keep a clock on who's watching stuff on the screen. That's the number of people who actually read the memo. Imagine the office talk and the hallway chatter and so on. So one can assume that the entire CIA hierarchy was aware that the CIA, that al-Qaeda was in America. This was at a time when George Tenet was saying we're waging war, declaring war on al-Qaeda. He said his hair was on fire. And, you know, all that. And yet at the same time, they all know al-Qaeda's in America. And what do you do? You know, well, CIA has no authority to work in America, nor had they ever penetrated al-Qaeda. This is despite the fact that young guys were walking into these camps in Afghanistan just every day, but they never could get a person in al-Qaeda. So in August of 2001, late August, the CIA finally tells the FBI that that there are these two guys that they know of that are in America. And why did they tell the FBI finally? Probably because they lost them. They didn't know where they were. And certainly they couldn't tell the FBI where they were. So what happened? What the FBI thinks, and what I think is a plausible answer, is that the Saudis were running these guys for the CIA. And you know, they did have, I mean, they had a guy from the consulate in L.A. meet them accidentally in a halal restaurant and then offer to take them to San Diego and pay their first month rent and, you know, pretty generous offer. But I think that that's probably what happened, but we don't know what happened. And we don't know why the CIA didn't tell the FBI. We, you know, that we've never, and but look at the consequences. And Ali Sufan, when he was investigating the coal, he came upon a reference to a meeting that had taken place in Kuala Lumpur just before those hijackers came to America. And he thought it might have something to do with the bombing of the coal. So on three occasions, he asked the CIA, it's very formal when it goes to the director of the FBI, it is then transmitted to the director of the CIA, formally asking for information. Now remember, 19 American sailors were killed in that bombing. And he's asking for information in regards to the investigation of those deaths. And the CIA says they know nothing about this meeting in Kuala Lumpur. In fact, they actually had the Malaysian authorities surveil it. And it was from that meeting those two hijackers flew to LA and then to San Diego. So the FBI, the CIA not only knew they were present in America, they hid the ball from the FBI even before they came. 3,000 people paid with their lives because of that. And think how our world might have been different had we stopped 9/11, as could have been done, because the CIA, the FBI had a warrant on al-Qaeda. They could have followed these guys. They could have cloned their computers. They could have, you know, there's so many things they could have done had they only known that they were present in America. Now, that's one. The other is, you know, the lead up to the war on Iraq. We were told, you know, I think I understood that Iraq didn't have, that Saddam Hussein didn't have very much to do with al-Qaeda, if anything. He was a secular leader, you know. Bin Laden hated him, but what was interesting is, you know, this whole stuff about weapons of mass destruction, and when Colin Powell went to the United Nations to give his statement and ask for support, he said that, you know, he cited this al-Qaeda member named Ibn Sheikh al-Libi, who had testified or had told his story was that Saddam Hussein had weapons of mass destruction and that he was working with al-Qaeda and they were going to share the weapons. Well, I trusted my government enough to believe that they wouldn't lie about it. But where that information actually came from, Ibn Sheikh al-Libi was not actually a member of al-Qaeda. He was in one of the training camps in Afghanistan, and they picked him up in November 2001. And the FBI was interrogating him, and he was being cooperative. But then the CIA came and snatched him away. And what they did, this was before we began torturing our own people, you know, our own suspects, they sent him to Egypt. Michael Scheuer, who was head of the bin Laden station at CIA, said the nice thing about Egypt is you send them there in the morning, you get the afternoon, you get the answers in the afternoon. And sure enough, they got the answers they were looking for, that Saddam Hussein and al-Qaeda were working together and they had weapons of mass destruction. Well, this was frightening and a lie. That had been produced by torture. And no one's been held accountable for that either. And I could go on about, you know, destruction of the videotapes of the torture and so on. There are many different things, but the record shows nobody has been held accountable for anything. And, you know, there's 9/11 on the one hand, and then there's Iraq. Iraq and Afghanistan, now the two longest wars in our history, set aside the bloodletting by, depending on how you account it, $4 to $6 trillion. $1 trillion. Just imagine what good could have been that we could have used that money for. Even Bernie Sanders wouldn't have enough to spend. And instead we invested it in misery. We made the world a worse place. We created chaos in Iraq. We allowed ISIS to grow and bloom into the entity that it is now. Hundreds of thousands of people are dead. It's, you know, the world is a worse place because of that. Nobody's been held accountable for that.
Do you think that the government has learned anything? I mean, is there still this wall between the CIA and the FBI? Do they share information?
No, that's changed. And it's not perfect. The intelligence community has been reorganized. It's always been chaotic and at odds with each other. There are 16 different intelligence agencies. And there's been bitter turf wars between them, exemplified in the relationship between John O'Neill and Michael Scheuer, O'Neill at the FBI and Scheuer at the CIA. And and Scheuer testified before Congress a couple of years ago that the only good thing that happened on 9/11 was a building fell on John O'Neill. Well, that's the relationship of the FBI and the CIA in a nutshell. And since then, the National Counterterrorism Center has been established, and that's helped things. But, you know, the flow of information is not unimpeded, and our intelligence agencies still make mistakes. You know, we're fortunate to have them, but I've often wondered if they're, you know, this penchant for secrecy and for covering up has not done us more damage than the good that they have done.
I'm going to ask one last question, and then I'll open it up to the audience. So ISIS, who would they want to win this presidential election? Because obviously, you know, Hillary's kind of a hawk and might do more over there, which they would want. And then you've got Donald Trump, who wants to ban Muslims. Which is better? Which would they want more?
Well, I think they're having the best time right now making such a choice. But I really do think that on balance, well, let me think about this moment and be a little bit. If you are ISIS and you have the worldview they have, the alliance of Trump and Putin might be sobering, right? You know, a dictator and a madman, you know, who knows what they might do. And Hillary, you know, her recipe for resolving Syria is, you know, largely to try to, you know, expand the zone by maybe a no-fly zone of containment. And I think that that's probably the best approach to Syria, although she's a little hawkish, in my opinion. One thing that I've learned, and maybe you, from your experience, came to the same conclusion, in dealing with the Middle East, things can always get worse.
It's true. Well, on that sobering note, let's open it up to questions.
So we have a mic right here, as you can see, for folks, if you have questions. We're going to take five people to begin with. So I saw a hand over there. Come on up. Are you coming up to ask a question? All right.
And again, I will interrupt you if you make a speech, because I'm like that.
Thanks very much. We had in New York over the weekend the 9/11 Truth Commission hearings about the demolition of Building 7, which came down, as you remember, straight down, wasn't hit by a plane or anything like that. And that certainly impressed me as part of the whole terrorism story. And we're looking for a new investigation. Can you comment on your information, your knowledge about that particular attack, and whether that, how you see that, and the possibility of a new investigation into the towers coming down? Thank you.
You're welcome. First of all, Building 7 was not attacked. It was part of the general conflagration in that region. When I first had my book come out, I had 9/11 truthers following me around after speech. And the general presumption is that if a plane hit a skyscraper, that's not what would happen. And most of them agree that a plane hit the skyscraper because, you know, there were, you know, cameras
video.
And, you know, yeah, so. But the experiment of running a jetliner into a skyscraper has only happened twice. And in both cases, the building fell down. But if you take the presumption that that's not what happened, that couldn't happen that way, then what happened? And the next iteration of that is often that the American government knew that there was going to be an attack, but they feared that it was going to fail. And so they packed the skyscrapers with explosives in order to guarantee that it succeeded. This idea is so far from being plausible, but on the other hand, people believe what they want to believe, and it accords with their view of the world. And unfortunately, it's Americans that came up with this notion, and it's now you find it all over the Arab world. Well, your own people say you did it yourself. And
Or Israel did it. That's
or
the
Israel
other one
Mossad
hear.
Was in on it. And so my feeling about Building 7 is that, you know, there was a barn fire, and the barn next door, you know, got caught in it. And, you know, it's mysterious why it fell down like that. But I don't think that there is a widespread plot to attack Building 7 or the World Trade Center. I've also had people tell me that the Pentagon was not attacked by that plane. And, you know, if that's true, where are the passengers? Where's the plane? People saw it happen. I grew up in Dallas. So conspiracy theories have been a part of my life forever, and it's a phenomenon that I've never stopped being interested in.
My question is about the issue of hostages and ransom. What do you see as the consequences, if any, of governments and individuals perhaps paying ransom for hostages and captives? And what's your opinion about it?
This is really hard because there's no question that ISIS has raked in hundreds of millions of dollars in ransoms. And European countries pay for their citizens. So when this, you know, Jim Foley and Steve Sotloff and Peter Kasich and Kayla Mueller and Theo Padnos were being held, Europeans were being held, and they were getting out, saying goodbye, going home. And they, you know, their governments paid, you know, we don't know how much they paid, but let's say in the $10 million or something, $20 million each, you know. That's a fair amount of revenue. And with that money, ISIS is able to commit more mayhem in the world. There's no question about it. So it was the principled stand that the American government took is we're not going to do that. Even though if you are kidnapped by the cartel in Mexico, the FBI will personally handle the ransom payment for you. In fact, every Federal Reserve Bank in the country has a stash of cash to be used in case of ransoms. It's not marked, it's just, you know, there in case of emergency. And so, you know, there's a disparity. Now, the families were being asked to pay, you know, absurd amounts of money. These were all very modest families. But the government was telling them, if you pay the money, we will prosecute you. You will be violating the law, which is material support of terrorism. And they didn't have the money themselves to do it anyway. But if they were to raise the money, even if they went on Kickstarter, everybody that contributed would be subject to that kind of penalty. And the government was actively threatening it. I mean, that was the main response they were getting from the government, not real help. They were getting threats. And Obama finally modified that. He said that, you know, if one of his daughters were kidnapped, he'd do anything. So he removed the penalty on the families, but not on the people who might contribute. So if you happen to be one of those families that has an extra $10 or $20 million, then you can pay it and the government will pay no attention to you. But it's unclear what would happen if you solicited money from other people. And my feeling about it, I don't think that the government should stand in the way of anybody trying to rescue their child. I couldn't bear it if it were my child. And I understand the moral dilemma. I also don't think the government should pay for it either. When governments actually finance it, the price goes up. And so I think that's what's happened with the Europeans is they've established a very high bar because the, you know, the French government or the Belgian government is paying for it, and they you know, it's not such a dip into the expenses.
A great question.
Hi. When I read the New York Times Magazine Fractured Lands piece, I was struck by the idea that as long as there are political boundaries in the Middle East that don't align with the tribal boundaries, it will sort of always be destabilized. Is that something you agree with? And if so, sort of how do we go from there?
Well, I think it's true that, you know, to some extent, these are, you know, the remnant of the fall of the Ottoman Empire and, you know, British and French colonial powers dividing up areas of interest. They did attempt to carve out somewhat coherent entities. But I don't think it's so much a matter of the tribes and stuff like that. I think it's the absence of tradition of a nation state in the region anyway. I'm not sure if you reshape the puzzle pieces, if it would make any difference. And, you know, take the example of the Kurds. You know, they're spread over a wide area. If you wanted to break up Iraq the way that Joe Biden had proposed into a Sunni zone, a Shia zone, and a Kurdish zone, you would find it very difficult to do because they don't all happen to live, you know, in one particular place. And there's not a single country in the Middle East that has been comfortable with the nation state beyond Egypt, I think. Egypt is certainly not a perfect country. But it has a sense of itself. It's almost eternal as a nation. And so it's one country that I think can hold together like that. But elsewhere in the Middle East, we can talk about tribes. We can talk about, you know, religious sects and so on. But the truth is, until the nation state is accepted as an entity, then I don't think that there's going to be an easy way for these countries to govern themselves.
Okay, what are some of the ideas or the draws that al-Qaeda and the other groups are using to draw our youngsters in America, in Europe, and in other westernized places?
When we're speaking about foreign fighters being drawn into this conflagration in the Middle East, I think a lot of it has to do with issues of identity. And in Europe, and I fear Europe is in dire trouble. You have a situation like in France where 8 to 10% of the population is Muslim. More than 60% of their prisoners are Muslim. Can you imagine a more stark measure of the degree of alienation in a country than that? And those young Muslims don't feel French, nor do the French feel like they're French either. And so who are they? And, you know, if you're a young man named Muhammad in Belgium, for instance, which happens to be, for instance, the most common given name in Belgium now, and you're not Flemish, you know, you may not even speak Arabic, you're second generation or something, but who are you? If you're in Belgium or France, or you probably... If someone asks you, you say, I am Muslim. Mm. And so if you feel that way, it's not surprising you go to the mosque and you consort with other young Muslims who also feel alienated and marginalized. And in that environment, it's very easy to become radicalized. The unemployment rate of Muslims in Europe is staggering. So there's very little that young people who are bursting, like all young people, to do something in the world and make a mark. What can they do? Al-Qaeda and ISIS offer you a chance to build a utopia and make history. And that's a very powerful narrative. Now, it's different in this country. We are, you know, there have been thousands of Muslims out of Europe and Russia going into Syria. The FBI knows of only 250 Americans who have even tried. And that's because our Muslim community is very different. The average Muslim in America has more education than the average American, makes a higher wage, and is less likely to go to prison than the average American. What a contrast.
Yeah,
that's, you know, that's why we're really blessed in this country with people who, in questions of identity, they would say, who are you? And they would say, I'm an American Muslim.
That's for white America, but in the prisons and the black
I can't hear you very well.
I said that's for white America, but in my community, they're full on being infiltrated,
radicalized. Yeah.
In the black communities, they're all over the place, and especially in the prisons. In the prisons, they snap them up, and they come out, they're very much radicalized. As a matter of fact,
I'm going to stop you.
Okay, I'm sorry.
No worries.
But she's absolutely...
Because you've got a really good point. And if
she's
you wanna,
absolutely
yeah,
right
yeah.
about the role of prisons everywhere. Or, you know, these are jihadi universities. And it's a tremendous problem because there's nowhere people are more susceptible to being radicalized. And they're a captive population by definition.
Right.
Hello. I was wondering if you have an opinion about the Seymour Hersh allegation that Pakistan knew about Osama bin Laden's location and was holding him prisoner, and they knew about the raid. And does your research and reporting consistent with that, or more consistent with the administration's telling?
I don't have a strong opinion about it. I it's plausible that the Pakistanis knew that bin Laden was there. I think it's implausible that they told America that he was there. And he was staying in Abbottabad, which is, you know, a military compound. And, it was like if he was in McLean, Virginia, it would be a real surprise to find, you know, somebody like that staying right next to the CIA. But So if I were to find out that the Pakistanis knew he was there, that would be completely believable to me. But the scenario in which this whole thing was a rigged, to use a popular word now, rigged kidnapping murder, it doesn't ring true to me, but I'm not saying that it's not.
Well, thank you both so much for joining us. Oh, you want more?
I figured
questions?
We could like end it with. Anybody sure. have Larry's book? Because you have it with you. Because I want you to read the last three paragraphs. It's a good way to.
This gentleman has. Oh well, thank you.
I like the idea of spoiling the ending of the book for everybody. So I'm gonna have him do that.
You'll be the first one I sign then. All right. In the epilogue, three graphs. All right.
You'll know where it starts with the asterisks.
Yeah. Oh, I know this part. One day in 1965, I took a date to the airport. I was a senior in high school in Dallas, Texas, and I didn't have enough allowance to go to the movies. Love Field, as it is actually called, was a common destination for cheap dates. An American Airlines jetliner had just arrived from some exotic locale, Paris, we supposed, and my girlfriend and I walked out on the tarmac and climbed up the ramp into the plane. The flight attendants were cleaning up as we sat in the first class cabin. One of them actually gave us a snack. After that, we went into the FAA tower. "Come on in, kids," a flight controller said as I cracked open the unlocked door. We sat on stools and watched the landing lights of the incoming flights like fireflies in the summer night. That America is gone. Terrorism killed it. That America is not remembered or even imagined by younger people who have never experienced such freedom and who have no way of calculating the many sacrifices of liberty that have been made in the name of the war on terror. This age of terror will end one day, but whether our society can restore the feeling of freedom that once was our birthright is hard to predict. The security state that has grown up since 9/11 has transformed our culture, and yes, we needed the protection. We are often reminded that we must never forget what happened on that fateful day. But if we fail to keep in mind the country we were before 9/11, we may never steer in that direction again. In that case, the terrorists really will have won. Thank you.